CBS News in Washington. This is the CBS News Nightwatch. This morning, even before the Iran-Contra scandal broke, the Christic Institute was filing suit over the resupply network. But do they think Congress got the full story?
The Democratic Party has made a very specific decision not to probe deeply into the existence of this secret team and what it is they've been doing.
And we're going well beyond that. I dare say that the American public deserves something more serious than the hand-holding that went on in the Senate Select Committee here.
The Iran-Contra hearings told...
May of last year, an organization called the Christic Institute filed a lawsuit. It charged that a gun and drug smuggling network was operating in Central America. At the time, most people scoffed. Then the Iran-Contra scandal broke, and people started paying attention to the Christic Institute and to its goals. Its members use legal means to address what they see as abuses by government and by corporations. Two of the driving forces behind the Institute join us this morning, Chief Counsel Daniel Sheehan and Co-Director, the Reverend Bill Davis. Welcome.
Good morning.
When did you start this?
We started this just after we had won the Karen Silkwood case back in 1979. We incorporated the Christic Institute in January of 1980. So we've been in operation since that time doing national litigation.
Christic means what?
It's a term that comes from a French anthropologist, actually. He was a man who, Teilhard de Chardin, who connected serious science with religion. And he talked about the evolutionary force, or he says if you're Christian, people talk about the force of Christ. But he tried to combine the two in the term Christian.
Science and religion.
Yeah, so we use it because we like the fact that we take science and social sciences seriously, but we see that as part of our religion and not something separate.
Contradictions?
No, that there are no contradictions between a really modern outlook, a theological outlook, and a modern scientific outlook.
How many members?
Right now we're up to 42.
Yeah. Money comes from?
Well, mainly from a lot of the direct mail from people around the country, and also from religious organizations, social ministry offices of the Christian and Jewish denominations, and also from a number of foundations around the country that support public justice work, similar to the people who fund the American Civil Liberties Union, the NAACP, and others.
If somebody was trying to put you on the political spectrum, where would they put you?
Well, what they say about us is that we're dramatically more progressive than the liberals and dramatically more traditional than the conservatives.
And what does that mean in terms of issues?
Don't really know what to do with us. What we do is we take issues that are major public policy issues that haven't broken yet.
Tell us about the suit that you filed. I'm swinging back and forth here simply because the two of you are here.
The lawsuit is a civil complaint. It's really based upon the injury to two American citizens. They're journalists, Tony Avergan and Martha Honey, who live in Costa Rica, as a matter of fact, their husband and wife team. They were injured as a result of the activities of this secret team. And so we're saying that they should be able to recover civil damages by suing not just the people who did the bombing, which injured them down there, but the people further up the line who conspired together illegally to open a southern front against Nicaragua. And we've named in the complaint a number of people who had hardly been heard of at that time. General Secord, his business partner Albert Hakim, Rob Owen, the personal representative of Ollie North. People like this, when we filed the lawsuit, the public hardly knew who they were. But of course now, since the Hassenfuss plane went down and since the Iran scam affair has happened, these names are almost household words.
And your theory is what? The premise of the suit is that... tell us what happened so that we'll understand the premise of the suit.
What happened was in 1984, in May of 84, someone tried to kill Eden Pastora, one of the Contra leaders. And they did it by setting off a bomb at a press conference, knowing full well that reporters would be killed at the same time. In fact, they wanted to kill international reporters because their theory was that it'll clearly be blamed on the Sandinistas and it will advance the cause of destroying their reputation in the U.S. So our plaintiffs were hurt as a result of that bombing, and they did, first of all, their own investigation in Costa Rica. They thought it may have been the Nicaraguans who had caused this injury, but they quickly discovered that it was a team of terrorists who operated out of a ranch in northern Costa Rica owned by a U.S. citizen, John Hull,
right,
who I think has been on your program.
Yeah, he has indeed.
That he was a CIA contract agent, that he was doing things, he was the main CIA contact point in northern Costa Rica.
Because he owned lots of land.
He owns lots of land, he has a landing strip, that arms were being brought into his land, and that it was being used as a transit point for drugs.
He acknowledges all of that. I'm not sure about the transit point for drugs, but he acknowledges that he owns a lot of land, that he's friendly with the CIA, denies that he is an agent, and denies he has anything to do with...
Now he acknowledges, although it's interesting, that originally he sued our clients for libel in Costa Rica when they published the fact that he was connected with the CIA. He sued them for that. Now he admits it.
All right. One final point. What's the connection, before we go to some videotape I want you to see, including John Hull?
Good.
What's the connection between Secord and Owen and those guys and the explosion?
Well, they were supplying the C4 explosives that were being knowingly transported into Costa Rica that were going to be used to attack civilians inside Nicaragua. They were part and parcel of this entire Neutrality Act conspiracy to violate the Federal Neutrality Act that prohibits anybody from mounting a private military operation against a government with whom the United States has diplomatic relations. So because of that, they are guilty, in fact, of violating the Federal Racketeering Act.
RICO.
The RICO statute, which prohibits people from engaging in terrorist acts of killing, arson, you know, drug smuggling, and these things, all of which they've been actively engaged in.
You don't believe, though, do you, that Secord or Hakim or Owen or Hall knew that there were going to be a bomb placed at this table where Eden Pastore was going to have a press conference?
Well, that's the purpose of the racketeering statute. You see, that if in fact the don of a mafia family,
right,
is able to say, well, I didn't know that this particular mom-pa drugstore was going to be set on fire on Friday night to extort money from them, then he could get out of it. The whole point of the racketeering statute is to get all the people that are involved in the conspiracy and allow them to be sued.
I understand that, but do you believe that General Secord, who all of America knows because of his testimony, and Rob Owen, who read a poem about Oliver North at the end of his testimony written by John Hall, do you believe they knew that there would be an attempt made against Eden Pastore?
Well, it's clear that John Hall did, that Hall was intimately clear that he knew? Because he, in fact, was meeting with the bomber before the bombing took place. We have the bomber on videotape placing the bomb in the press conference and then fleeing. And we have eyewitness testimony of an intelligence officer from the Internal Security Forces in Costa Rica testifying to participating in meetings with the bomber in John Hall over a month before the bombing took place, and then delivering money from associates of John Hall to the man who was in charge of the investigation that then called it off.
All right, let me take a break here. Then when we come back, we will see John Hull in an interview I did, and also Pedro Joaquin Chamorro and others, as we continue this conversation about the Christic Institute and their work and some lawsuits they have brought. Stay with us. Talking about the Christic Institute and also about the attempted assassination of Eden Pastore. Eden Pastore was Commandant Zero, was one of the leaders, one of the dramatic, charismatic leaders of the Sandinistas. He later fled from Nicaragua because of his differences with the Sandinistas, then joined the Contra Revolution, and later, because of some differences with the CIA and with others, he has left, and he's now fishing somewhere off the coast of Costa Rica, as I understand it.
That's correct.
All right. Look at this videotape now. This is John Hall, who has been mentioned, and also Pedro Joaquin Chamorro. Pedro Joaquin Chamorro is the son of the famous Chamorro publishing family that owned La Prensa, and it was the death of his father that gave a lot of impetus to the Sandinista Revolution. Having said all that, look at the tape. Who tried to kill Eden Pastore?
Well, there's no proof of that. I can assure you that I didn't. I can assure you that Rob Owen or Ollie North or none of those people did. One of the fighters that was there, and he has given a statement on tape, which I'll be glad to give to you. He says it was a publicity stunt of Pastore himself. Whether his statements are true, I have talked to two others that basically back up his statement.
Do you know, Pedro, who is responsible for the attempted assassination of Eden Pastore?
No, I don't.
Who do you suspect?
Well, the Sandinistas.
So what do you think?
It's about what one would expect from
both of them.
Yes. But I think the
even
fact,
from Chamorro.
He just said
yes.
He didn't know.
Well,
he
tried to blame it on the Sandinistas, though, and it's quite clear that the original intent of this was to make the Sandinistas look bad.
Yeah.
And as a matter of fact, this same group were planning other terrorist events and were definitely planning to use it as a pretext to turn public opinion against the Sandinistas. Yeah. So.
Let me come to another point, which you have mentioned to me, is that you believe that this effort down there predated Alba North?
Well, that's right. The fact of the matter is, if people look back into the history of this, we will remember that the Harkin Amendment was passed, sponsored by Tom Harkin, Senator Harkin, to cut off all military assistance to Somoza's regime because of their consistent violation of human rights. That became effective in October of 1977. These men that we see now being paraded before national television used to be high-level representatives in the Central Intelligence Agency, in the Foreign Military Sales Divisions of the Pentagon, etc. What they did is many of these men were forced out of the government under President Carter's administration. In fact, 820 men were forced out of the Operational Directorate or Covert Operations Division of the CIA during the Carter administration. What they did is, since they disagreed so vehemently with the Carter policies, they set up private corporations. They set up the Egyptian American Transport and Service Company, for example, and they began to supply...
They is who?
This is Richard Secord, Theodore Shackley, Albert Hakim, a man by the name of Eric von Marbod, Rafael Quintero, all names that you've heard discussed as part of this enterprise of Richard Secord. The fact of the matter is, they set up that enterprise to give support to Somoza, to give him arms and money and supplies to try to keep him in power, even though it was the United States government policy to cut him off from that, because they were now private citizens.
And what evidence is there of that?
There's direct meetings that took place that we've got memos of, where Ed Wilson, who was working with them as one of their partners in ITSCO, and Tom Kleins went and met with Somoza, offering him deals. We've got copies of the contracts. There have been interviews by the FBI of a man named Douglas Schlachter, who participated in those meetings. They undertook to keep him in power. When he fell from power in July of 1979, Chichi Quintero and these men met with Anastasio Somoza and his military commanders at a place called Norman Cay, off in the Bahamas. They set up an agreement to continue to supply the military equipment, not to Somoza as the head of the Nicaraguan government anymore, but to his military commanders to organize this contra force. This operation was going from 1979 to 1981, when President Reagan came to office. What the secret team of men did is they simply passed the contra ball to the Reagan administration. And then Bill Casey and Vincent Canestraro and the CIA undertook to supply and recruit and fund this particular contra operation until they were caught in 1984 mining the harbors and passing out the assassination manual. What happened then was that the administration, when it was prohibited under the Bolin Amendment from giving any aid direct or indirect to the Contras, they simply turned the ball back over to the secret team, but they kept a liaison with the secret team that was Oliver North.
And it was Bill Casey, as I remember, not knowing some of the aspects of your story, although Peter Moss has written a lot about this in New York Times Magazine about this connection of these people, some who had served with honor and distinction in the United States, Secord in Vietnam,
and
others. As I understand it, didn't Casey introduce or recommend Secord to North?
That's right. That's right. And then North recommended Rob Owen to Secord.
Yeah.
And what they did is they, see, the whole impression that the United States Congress is attempting to give to the people is totally false. That somehow this group was set up by Oliver North and maybe John Poindexter after the Congress passed the Bolin Amendment, just because the Reagan administration wanted to continue a policy that Congress had forbidden.
Yeah.
And it's a total mirage. And all they have to do is look back past the October 84 date, and they'll see where this team came from.
All right, let me take a break and we'll come back. How many of these members of this team are suing you?
None that I know of.
No, none of them are suing the Christian Institute at all?
No.
Is anybody suing you?
No.
Nobody?
Nobody.
Nobody's angry at you? Nobody's challenging your
facts? I assume they're angry at us, but the fact is that they're the ones that are engaged in the racketeering operation and they've got no charge against
us. No countersuits at all?
No.
Okay.
No.
Back in a moment. Stay with us.
Family planning clinics are the latest battlefield in the abortion debate. We'll explore the Reagan administration proposal that touched off the controversy ahead.
Okay, we heard the outlines of the case. Now, you hope to do what by the lawsuit? Let me bring... It's interesting, when I get to the legal questions, I turn to the, the father.
I'll defer to Danny, but first of all, win justice for the two plaintiffs who were injured. But I think, more importantly, this lawsuit is going to be a motherload of information to the American public who are not getting the information about this secret team and about the fact that they...
Well, but they just had all these people up there.
Oh, what they've had...
Richard Secord and Albert Hakim and Rob Owen, and they've had all these investigators.
They've had them up there, but they've had them up there with people like Ed Meese setting the parameters of deciding what the smoking gun would be, i.e., did the president know...
No, but that's not fair. I mean,
they're also...
Ed Meese didn't determine the scope of the investigation. By the Congressional Committee.
That's true, but there are a lot of forces that did, including the fact that 16 out of the 26 people questioning them, the senators and representatives, are people who had voted for Contra Aid, and all of whom have their own political needs to keep this thing within bounds, i.e. keep it from 1984 and so on.
I don't believe that, let me make the argument that would be made by a lot of other people. I mean, people like Sam Nunn, who may have voted for Contra Aid, would disagree that would cause him to pull back from an investigation if he thought there was a link. But I don't think there are too many people who have supported David, chairman of the Senate Intelligence Committee, has supported Contra. These are people, men of integrity and good judgment, who would not, because of their vote, pull back on the investigation.
No, it's not that they pulled back, Charlie. It's important to remember that the charter for the special prosecutor was drafted by Ed Meese.
Yeah, but that's this independent counsel.
But that's right.
But that's not the committee.
But the Congress set up its select committees in direct reaction to the appointment of the special prosecutor. When the special prosecutor was appointed by the Court of Appeals, then the Congress introduced resolutions to set up their investigations of similar things. Mm-hmm. They have the exact same timeline, you see. That's what's so obvious about this. They have the exact same timeline that Ed Meese put in the charter. And it's totally arbitrary.
What does the timeline mean?
October of 1984.
Oh, they've got to have a...
That's when they start
their investigation.
That's right. They're looking from October of 1984 to November of 1986. Yeah. And if you look at that single period, you get the impression that somehow this organization was the creation of Oliver North and John Poindexter, who became very active after the passage of the Boland Amendment.
Yeah, but since you say that, but the problem is that, as I mentioned to you, Peter Moss has written about this in the New York Times Magazine. There's been all kinds of journalistic, all kinds of different reporters have written about the connection between this whole group of men that you mentioned.
Except that Peter Moss pointed out that he didn't know anything about it when in the very beginning of his New York Times article.
Right, my point is that this is not an unknown fact to serious journalists who've written this connection between...
That's right.
That these people had worked together in various forms. It even goes back to Vietnam.
That's right. It goes back to the Bay of Pigs, actually,
in Cuba. And if I could add, one element of it, for instance, is the whole drug element. Why is it that none of these people have seriously questioned these defendants about the drug connection when it's well established now, both on national television and in smaller Senate and congressional hearings and in our own court case? It's well established that, as a matter of fact, there were drug dealings on the part of some of these Contras, lying arms down and drugs back, and that whole element wasn't mentioned.
Yeah, that element has been mentioned on this network. West,
but the question is, why didn't the senators and Congress people go into it? I don't think it's a question of them being totally corrupt. I'm not saying that. It's just that they have accepted the rules of the game and the parameters within which they're forced to work for political reasons. And we're going well beyond that. I dare say that the American public deserves something more serious than the hand-holding that went on in the Senate Select Committee hearing.
Yeah, but my only question about that, my only sort of curiosity about that is, if there is a connection, I can think of a number of members of that committee who would be anxious to plow that ground. Mm-hmm.
Well, let me point out.
I mean, you know, it's one thing to suggest that the committee hasn't done its job because of incompetence or because they allowed themselves to be connected to narrow their scope out of omission.
Well, it's more serious than that, I would say. Is that the fact of the matter is that the Democratic Party has made a very specific decision not to probe deeply into the existence of this secret team and what it is they've been doing, because they have such a great opportunity here to give people the impression that this was the product of bungling and incompetence on the part of the Reagan administration.
one you're suggesting was a much deeper conspiracy that stretched back over many administrations.
Exactly right.
Democratic and Republican.
Exactly right. And they do not want to open up that door. They want to have a very simple message to send to the American people that the Reagan administration, like the Nixon administration, are corrupt and they've misused the national security apparatus, and therefore you should allow the Democratic Party to have the presidency and to run your Congress. And it's because of their limited objective of the Democratic Party and their short-term political objectives, this is not malicious or malignant. It's simply a product of what their objective is.
Have you talked to Arthur Lyman?
Sure I have.
And what does Arthur Lyman say?
What Arthur Lyman said when I first met with him, he said, you mean that these people are not motivated simply by personal graft and greed? That this is an ideological thing that's been going on for some time, it's going to be much harder to get the congressman to be interested in that. That was exactly what he said to me. And so he went down the road of trying to show that Oliver North was using money to buy snow tires, that in fact that Dick Secord was motivated to buy a Porsche, and that's where they're going to try to go. And that doesn't explain what's going on here at all. It's a misservice.
Well, it seems to me that where they're going, is that the sort of, if you look at the summations that were made at the time of the end of the public hearings, you know, they talked about this hunter within the government and Poindexter North, and, you know, they created this sort of secret government within the government, and they blocked out and blocked out Shultz and Weinberger from the
Which, of course, isn't the problem. It was a private group that, in fact, contacted the administration and got them involved in their activities, and all they're focusing on is the people inside the administration, Oliver North and Poindexter.
Trying to make it look like a management problem.
Let me finally close about this. Christic Institute, how many members, you say?
42 at present.
Yeah, and does it have a political coloration at all?
We believe in very traditional values, and we're trying to make the system work as it is. I would say we're very progressive, and so we're frequently called leftists.
Progressive, yeah, okay.
I don't
care about that, do you? Are you worried about somebody thinking
about
leftist?
No, but I don't particularly like it, because I think it's a way of not taking the issues seriously. It's a way of writing off the group to a whole constituency that's out there.
And the fact is that we are highly criticized by Marxist organizations charged with red baiting and everything else, because we point out that Marxism and state capitalism and state communism are both Hegelian concepts that are totally different than natural law, where we come from.
We will follow this case and perhaps come back and talk about it more. Thank you both.
Pleasure.
Thank you, John.
Night Watch continues.